Hey, what's going on? Steve Kripke here, and good morning. You know, I'm fully blessed and honored and privileged and excited that you're here today. It just makes me excited that we have an opportunity to spend together. You know, it was interesting. I was listening to some Christ followers lately, recently, and hearing what they have to say about mission and vision and what they're looking to create. And I gotta say, it's really simple to lose our way. It's very easy to get swallowed up in the day-to-day activities. It's very simple to look at the ground when we should be looking up. And it's easy to hear the voices in our minds telling us that we shouldn't, couldn't, wouldn't, because we didn't. We should have. But we forget a lot of times that we have this mission here on earth that God has literally sent to us. He's given to us. He says, this is my mission for you. And that is spread my word to the four corners. And we sometimes feel small. How can I do it? How can I create this? How can I move forward in the face of the critics? And sometimes that critic is myself. And it can be difficult sometimes. We don't see ourselves as powerful enough or big enough. And you know, what's cool is that God has given us choice. And when we stop and slow down for a moment and stop seeing the world as attacking us individually and start looking at the world as they need help, they need guidance and direction, that the world is in trouble, that they don't have hope, that if you're a follower of Christ and you're struggling, imagine those that don't have that, and don't have that hope. Because as much of a breakdown as you and I have sometimes, we can always look up, kneel down, and place our struggles and trials and tribulations. We can trace them at the foot. We can place them at the foot of the cross. And I fully intend on, as we come to the Easter celebration, the rising of Christ, as Christians, we come together to celebrate the rising one, that the devil is going to be working overtime. So I think we should be very prepared for this as it happens, as these breakdowns come, that we have the strength of our Father. And then if we just look at the examples of Christ, he knew the things that were going to come, and he still stood strong in God's name. He turned to his Father in all times. Even when he suffered on the cross and he said, God, why have you forsaken me? See, as his faith was there, he knew his Father was there. Though he was struggling, he still turned to his Father. Dearest Father in heaven, guide us and direct us through today. Let your word shine free. Let your word shine down upon us. Help us see what you see. Help us remember the hope and the love and the freedom that you give us. That though we have choice, that we look to you to guide us through that choice. Then we gain our strength and our courage and our knowledge from you, Lord. We stop looking inward and we start looking outward. That we do what you have asked. And we do everything we can to glorify you, Lord, in all that we do. In Jesus' name, amen. So you may have thought that maybe I will Steve seems a little solemn this morning. And it's not it at all. I'm very intentional today on impact. And I'm very intentional. I've been in very deep intentions recently on impact. You see, on my whiteboard, I have this hashtag, and it's been sitting there since January 3rd of 2017. Over 2 years, it's hashtag create hope. And I believe that we don't create hope. We lead people to arenas that can help them see hope. And there's only one way, only one person, one being, one deity, one God that can create hope. And if we know this, if you and I know this, if we sit down and we really pay attention to what God is really giving us and bringing us and seeing through us and what he's creating in us, I believe it's absolutely 100% our duty to spread this hope to other people. And they may not want to hear it. Sometimes we need to speak in different ways, in different languages. And I'm not talking about Spanish, English, German, Russian. I'm talking about that person's language. To meet people where they are. To meet them with the anger that they're receiving in their mind and in their heart from the devil. To not make them wrong, but to give them comfort. I believe that if you love Jesus and you love what he stood for, and you love God, that we want to make our lives count for Christ. In Matthew chapter 9, it says, Jesus traveled through all the towns and villages of that area, teaching in the synagogues and announcing the good news about the kingdom. And he healed every kind of disease and illness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion of them because they were confused and helpless. How many times do you have a conversation with somebody and they just seem lost, scared, sad? Maybe it's you. I don't know. I do my best not to look to see who's on my calls. I want to keep my message clear, what God's telling me, not according to who I think it should be listening. See, a lot of times when we look in the mirror, we are faced with trials and tribulations. We see ourselves and we get scared, and as fear comes, anger comes. And as anger comes, that's a lot of us, it's our default. Anger is our default over sadness and despair because it feels better. It goes on, it says, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he gives hope. This is Matthew chapter 9, verses 35 through 38. He said to his disciples, the harvest is great, but the workers are few. So pray to the Lord who is in charge of the harvest. Ask him to send more workers into this field. So I think that's an amazing statement. I'm grateful that Christ put that in there. But what about you? What about me? Are we leading the examples? Or are we hiding? Are we leading the examples of a Christ-filled life? Or are we hiding? It's really not difficult when we lean on God. I believe that when we sit inside of our comfort, we're living on our own. God, I have to think that he thinks these words of, if you're living in a place of comfort, why do you need me? See, I believe God has created us in a way for us to move forward and create something bigger because well, that's how he created us. See, faith isn't made from sitting inside of our comfort zone. Faith lives in the realm of a perceived discomfort. And it's only uncomfortable because we're leaning on ourselves. What are people going to say about me? What are they going to do? They're going to judge me. People are going to see me differently. They're going to, whatever negative thing we decide to tell ourselves to keep ourselves from having conversations. I believe that when we step out into faith and that fear comes, the moment we say, God, I'm scared, will you help me? And he does. Doesn't that increase our faith immediately? Doesn't it give us the strength to move on? See, I believe that we should be impacting in the name of Jesus. So I'm going to go through four quick ways here. We need to see as Jesus saw. See, when Jesus looked at the crowd, he didn't see a bunch of people who were about to demand even more of his time and energy. He looked beyond the surface and realized that they were spiritually depressed and just lost. They had a spiritual hunger. See, most people have a spiritual hunger. They just don't know. They don't admit it. They don't speak it out loud until you show them what the food of Christ is. See, I have to ask you this question. When you look at the world today and you take a look at your neighbors and maybe you're walking through the mall or, you know, just looking at our country, what do you see? See, I don't know about you. I see a lot of despair, and I believe that I've taken it up as my own responsibility. And if it's just me, I'm fine. I will grasp on to the strength of our God, and I know that anything is possible because He's told me. And it sure would be great to have help. I don't need it because I have God. But we need to spread His word. We need to spread His hope. So when we start seeing as Jesus saw, we see this pain and discomfort in people, that even the ones that attack us. I believe it's our duty and our obligation to help relieve that pain. Number two is feel as Jesus felt, and this is hard. And this is what has kept me up at night recently, is the pain. And, you know, I can feel the suffering of people. When Jesus saw the crowds as He walked around, He was moved to compassion for them. He literally felt people suffering. He felt their broken heart as if it was His own. And it moved Him. Two incredibly powerful words inside the Bible, it says Jesus wept. So if it breaks your heart to see people, maybe we need to start reaching out and talking to them. And I'm not saying, hey, have you read Philippians 4:13? That's not what I mean. I'm talking about extending a handout of grace, even those that trespass against us. See, if our hearts are broken, then there's a good chance that somebody else is broken too. When we lean on God and we feel that comfort, that release of brokenness, and we feel healed, why would we keep that secret to ourselves? I believe that's living without integrity. I believe that we should be feeling like Jesus felt. He did something about it. We actually have, since we are born in the image of God, we are created in the image of God. We are born in His eyes. He created us from Himself. That we actually, in my opinion, and maybe you think I'm crazy here, I believe that we have the same opportunity as Christ did as He walked on the earth. And maybe we don't heal the blind, or maybe we do. I don't know. I'm looking and searching and constantly growing towards that level of faith. See, Peter didn't step out of the boat and walk on water because he was wishy-washy. He stepped out of the boat, put his feet firmly flat on water, and stood there, even if it was only for a moment, because he had faith, because he was staring right in the eyes of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And when we stare in the eyes of Christ, the possibilities become absolutely endless, except for he started losing focus off of Jesus like we do, and he started seeing the storms that are blowing around us, the waves that are coming over our heads, the thunder and the lightning crashing all around us. And then he started to sink, as we do. Except for he reached out to grab his father's outreached hand, and he was lifted up out of the water. And he kept them from drowning. Because Jesus felt what he was. I believe number three is we pray as Jesus prayed. Oh, man. You know, it's impossible to tell someone how to pray. You know, we have structure in the Bible, right? I don't believe prayer is structure. I believe prayer is something that you have conversation with God. Excuse me. I believe that, you know, one of the things that works well for me is I sit down and I ask God a question. And I shut my mind down for 10 minutes. And it's a measly 10 minutes a day. He spoke to me this morning. I didn't like his answers. I've got to follow them, though, because he spoke to me. And that's how I know that it wasn't from me, because he gave me the responses I didn't want to hear. I'm not discouraged, though, because if God's telling me what to do, then I also know that God has my back. Pray as Jesus prayed. You know, I believe that Jesus was saddened when he saw how much people were suffering. I also believe he wasn't discouraged. Instead, he asked God to send people to work in the harvest, knowing his Father was greater than any problem that we could face. You see, I believe that when we're called to action and we don't do it, that's that discomfort, man. Woo! Can I tell you that feeling of your heart that you're just not fulfilling purpose? And I have to remind myself on a day-to-day basis that I am a warrior for God, that I have a robe of righteousness, man. I walk with the shoes of gospel. And you and me are no different. When's the last time you asked God to send you into the harvest field? Oof. I feel like God is talking to me this morning. And this message is specifically designed for me. I have notes that I usually try to follow, or I attempt to follow. See, if we ask for that, God might just answer. And if you're not willing to go, do you really think it's right to ask God to send others? Do as Jesus did. Jesus didn't ask God to send. He said he got involved himself. He saw the crowds. His heart was moved by compassion. And he rolled up his sleeves and he got to work. And it's funny because when we do this, you know, when we ask and we're like, yeah, man, this is a tall order, Steve. And what happens if somebody makes fun of me? Or maybe I'm too old. I don't have enough money. You know, I don't have enough time. I'm afraid. It's too risky. I don't want to risk my friendships. But no excuse that we can ever come up with, nothing we can ever say to ourselves can disqualify us from doing the work of Christ. You're never too young or old or poor or busy or too fruitful or fearful or anything like that to be able to serve God, because all God requires is a willing heart. And if we give God that, he'll take things from there. He'll tell us what to say. He'll tell us who to talk to. He'll tell us everything we need to do in order to serve him the best. The biggest thing we need to do is really give it all up to him. It's amazing how powerful it is. When you just slow down for a minute and just listen, he's like, hey, man, what's up, Krivdin? I got your back, brother. Hey, you, I got your back. Let me have your back. When I reach out my hand to you, will you please grab it? And I believe that that's the way God is. I believe he's one of the most caring, compassionate, heart-filled, loving gods that has ever, that we could ever even compare ourselves to thinking. I believe that God fills us with all kinds of amazing things. He's just awesome. So I'm going to end it with this. And, you know, sometimes we're not sure. How can I serve? How can I create something bigger? Well, if we look at Luke 10:27, this is really cool, and I'll end it here, and we'll pray ourselves out of here. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. See, if we just loved our neighbors as we loved ourselves, which is loving God with all of our heart, soul, and strength, and our mind, what would that do? If we saw inside people, if we saw how Jesus saw, we saw the pain in their heart, not the anger, disdainful, jerky things that people say, but the pain that they have. If we felt that pain, if we prayed like he did, if we went on the mountain, just begged God, help me, and then actually put ourselves aside and listen to what he had to say and get rid of the devil's voice of all those insecurities, fears, and doubts, what kind of a world will we live in right now? I believe it would be a grace-filled, loving world. It would be a place where Christ could say, it's time for me to come back and bring my people back to heaven. It is time to bring my children home. It is time to remove the pain and the suffering. It is time for everlasting life. Dearest Father in heaven, thank you for this day, for blessing us so richly, Lord. Thank you for speaking to me today. I needed to hear this. Thank you for loving us more than you've loved yourself. Thank you for a sacrifice. And thank you for, most of all, salvation and grace that we can be forgiven for the stuff. Please be with those that can hear my voice, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In your precious and most glorious name, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Man, I hope this touched your heart today. I literally felt like I was the only one here. that the words that I spoke were God talking to me. Maybe that's selfish. I don't know. I pray that you welcome him with his strength, with all your heart, your soul, and your mind. God bless. Love y'all. Speak to you soon. Bye-bye.